is blockchain friend or fiend? And we're going to kick off with a keynote on the future of money. So it really is about looking forward. We're going to have a future stargazing session this morning, and someone who doesn't need a lot of introduction to other than to say he is a world-class expert in his field has come to South Africa to talk to us. Andreas Antonopoulos, welcome to South Africa and welcome to the conference.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I am so excited to be here. So this conference was called the Bitcoin Conference a couple of years ago, and now it's the Blockchain Conference. Next year, it's going to be the DLT technology. And then after that, it's going to be the database inspired by, but no longer in any way related to, Blockchain Conference. It's an interesting progression. Let me do a quick poll of the audience. I want to get an idea of your level of experience and familiarity with this space. So I'm going to go back to the yesteryears of Bitcoin. How many of you currently own Bitcoin? Fantastic. And those who don't own Bitcoin, how many of you have conducted a transaction or seen a transaction happen in Bitcoin? Great. And how many do not own any cryptocurrency of any type? Okay, great. How about people who are involved with Ethereum and own Ethereum? Great. Dash? Monero? Zcash? Got some interesting ones. Okay. How many own blockchain? How many have used blockchain in a transaction or in any way? Other than the five things I mentioned previously. All right. Okay, so breakdown for you, for those who can't see what the audience is doing. About 60 to 70% have Bitcoin at the moment or have conducted a transaction. About 30 or 40% with Ethereum. Smaller minority with Dash, Monero, and Zcash. Nobody owns blockchain. And this is interesting. This is exciting. Great. So let's get started. What exactly is going on here? Is this the greatest technological innovation and explosion of innovation since the mobile internet, or maybe even the internet itself? Or is this the greatest load of hype ever ranged around a technology in the history of technology? Both. And in fact, that's a characteristic of advanced technologies. I often say that where Bitcoin and the other open blockchains are today is approximately where the internet is in 1992. In terms of technology, in terms of infrastructure deployment, in terms of adoption patterns, this technology is approximately where the internet was in 1992. But the hype around blockchain is exactly where the hype around the internet was in 1998. You know what comes next. There will be a shakeout. When the waters recede, you can tell who on the beach wasn't wearing a swimsuit. They stand there naked. It's an empty promise. This will happen in the blockchain space. There is a lot of bullshit being peddled to VCs, to investors, to initial coin offering buyers, to uneducated investors. There's a lot of Ponzi schemes. There's a lot of pyramid schemes. There's a lot of empty promises. There's also a lot of business as usual disguised as innovation, disguised as disruptive technology. And so we're at this strange moment where the underlying technology really is, truly is, massively disruptive, massively innovative. The amount of research that's happening today in applied cryptography is unprecedented. we are looking at the largest civilian deployment of public key cryptography ever. Because it turns out that people only protect keys when those keys are attached to value, and nothing teaches someone security fast enough than having their Bitcoin on a Windows machine. Holding your own Bitcoin very quickly changes your attitude towards information security. You didn't care about your photos. Some didn't even care about your sexy photos. You didn't care about your location, the fact that everything you do was tracked. You didn't care about posting your entire life on Facebook. You used the same password, password 1234, on 17 different sites. You didn't know what two-factor authentication was, and then Bitcoin happened. And suddenly you're on a steep learning curve and getting better every day. Now you're telling your friends about two-factor authentication, and you're horrified to remember how you used to practice security because storing value has this unique ability to focus your mind on the aspects of security that matters. So this technology is driving this groundswell of security awareness. It's driving the most incredible research in applied cryptography we've ever seen. Some of you are probably quite technical. You're involved in computer science. You've seen what's happening here. Nobody thought that we would be doing applied Schnorr signatures. Nobody thought we'd be looking at advanced elliptic curve applications. Nobody thought we'd be doing things like ring signatures and range proofs for confidential transactions. The state of anonymity and privacy is advancing rapidly. We're building a whole new world in terms of cryptography, and this is applied cryptography on the largest cryptographically secured network the world has ever seen. That's not business as usual. It's highly disruptive. Now, out of that came this fantastic saying, blockchain is the technology behind Bitcoin, which is incorrect. Blockchain is one of the four foundational technologies behind Bitcoin, and it can't stand alone. But that hasn't stopped people from trying to sell it. Blockchain is Bitcoin with a haircut and a suit that you parade in front of your board. It's the ability to deliver a sanitized, clean, comfortable version of blockchain, of Bitcoin, to people who are too terrified of actually disruptive technology. And so you get into this very strange world where the words no longer mean anything. Can you define blockchain for me? I think a few people in this room could probably define blockchain, but the real challenge would be, can you define blockchain in such a way that I can't do search and replace with the word database and still make that sentence work? Because that's the challenge. If what you're doing is a database with signatures, it's not interesting. It's boring. What is the essence of Bitcoin? It's not blockchain. The essence of Bitcoin is the ability to operate in a decentralized way without having to trust anyone. The essence of Bitcoin is to be able to use software to authoritatively, independently, without appeal to authority, verify everything yourself. You don't trust the other nodes you're talking to. You assume they're lying. You don't trust the miners. You don't trust the people creating the transactions. You don't trust anything other than the outcome of your own verification and validation. And through that, you end up trusting in something more important, the network effect. Bitcoin introduced the concept of decentralized security through computation. And this has not yet sunk in. What Bitcoin does is it allows you to replace a security model that is based around concentric circles of access and control with an institution in the center, with a security model that is inside out, open, and accessible to everyone, a security model that is based on market forces and game theory. It is the first market-based security model, where a series of incentives and punishments ensure that the ultimate result is you can trust the platform itself as a neutral arbiter that is not controlled by anyone, without third parties, without intermediaries. Bitcoin revolutionizes trust. Now, it's difficult to have that conversation if you only focus on Bitcoin. And arguably, a lot of people have said, but it's not just about currency. What about the other applications? And it's not just about Bitcoin. What about the other blockchains? And so in that sense, the term blockchain means something. But only if you define it very, very narrowly. I use the qualifier open to talk about open blockchain. What I'm interested in is the applications of this technology that enable you to run a decentralized, trustless system that does not rely on anyone as an intermediary of trust. Because that is the disruption here. That is the essence of this technology. So that essence is seen in other systems. Ethereum exhibits it for the application of smart contracts. But those smart contracts only work if you don't have to trust anyone to execute the smart contract correctly. And you can only trust that that's going to happen if everyone can participate in an open manner and verify each other. If access to the underlying consensus algorithm in mining is open to everyone. And so out of these characteristics come the power of these blockchains technologies. Open. And that's the key word. Borderless. There are no borders. Transnational. This is no longer about nation states. This is about network-centric trust. Without third parties, the network is the trusted party, and only if you verify everything. Neutral. Because it isn't serving the goals of any one organization or institution. It follows the consensus rules neutrally. Everyone follows the consensus rules neutrally. Your transaction, there's no such thing as a good transaction or a bad transaction, a valuable transaction or a spam transaction, an authorized transaction or an unauthorized transaction, a legal transaction or an illegal transaction. In these systems, there is only a valid or an invalid transaction based on the consensus rules, and it doesn't matter who the sender is, who the recipient is, or what the value or asset or smart contract that's being executed is. Neutrality, radical neutrality. And, of course, censorship resistance. The ability to ensure that in order for the system to be open and borderless and transnational and neutral, it must be able to defend these properties by making it impossible for any actor, or even several colluding actors, from censoring, disrupting, blacklisting, restricting, seizing, freezing transactions, users, countries from participating in this network. Those are the important characteristics of these new, open, decentralized systems of trust that do not depend on institutions. So, what I'd like to equip you with is a set of criteria to understand when you are being presented with something, perhaps to invest, or to be employed, or to engage in some way, and it calls itself a blockchain, or a distributed ledger, or one of these other names that are coming out. How can you tell? Blockchain or bullshit? They both start with a B. What's the difference? If you can replace the word blockchain with database and the brochure reads the same, it's business as usual. It's not decentralized. It's not borderless, neutral, censorship resistant, open. It reestablishes trust in intermediaries. It's just a database. And that is not disruptive. The idea that we're going to take this technology and use it to improve the operating margins of centralized institutions of trust so that they can continue business as usual, I'd say it's abhorrent, but that's a strong word. It's just boring. Really, really boring. No one got into this in order to make a few billions for a financial services clearinghouse. And if you did, I'm really sorry. That's boring. What's really exciting is the possibility of fundamentally changing the way we allocate trust on this planet, opening up the ability to collaborate, transact, engage on a global level with everyone. Simply by means of downloading an application, you can become part of a giant platform of trust that doesn't care who you are or where you came from, that doesn't require permission to participate or innovate, where a 12-year-old JavaScript programmer has the same influence as power as JP Morgan Chase. More, in fact, because they're doing open source and feeding into a community of collaboration that is creating a tsunami of innovation. Taking this technology and using it to strengthen the same centralized institutions so that they can improve their bottom line is boring. That is not what blockchain is. That's just the database. And it doesn't change anything. In fact, there are some rather disturbing possibilities in this model. Let's think about it for a second. The most commonly expressed application for these new distributed ledger technologies is to replace the function of a centralized clearinghouse with a consortium of N participants, where N is 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, known, permissioned, controlled participants who will assemble transactions and sign them rather than compete through market forces in a security model like Bitcoin. We discard currency as the underlying mechanism for building market-based security. We discard proof of work as wasteful because all it allows you to do is decentralized, secure, neutral, censorship-resistant blockchain. And we trust five named parties to sign transactions. At that point, they don't need to assemble these transactions in blocks. They can just sign the individual transactions. They don't need to chain them together, because absent proof of work and a system of currency incentives, rewriting that is easy. There's no immutability. So it's not a blockchain anymore, because there's no blocks and there's no chain. Now, that's at a technical level. But let's look at the more important level. What do you achieve by replacing a clearinghouse with a consortium of players? You know, there's something unique a clearinghouse does. If you understand the role of a clearinghouse, one of its most important functions is that it is not a participant in the market. It has no skin in the game. The New York Stock Exchange is not an active trader. That's not an accident. That's called separation of concerns. The clearinghouse is an independent party with oversight that is not a market participant. If you take that party out and replace it with five banks, all of which have skin in the game, how do you run a consensus algorithm when the incentives to cheat, front-run, manipulate the market, and break the consensus rules, even adversarially against the other four parties, are so high. There's no incentive to keep the consensus rules. All you're doing is you're saying, trust us, we're in a consortium. Trust us? These five banks? Where were you in 2008? Where were you when Libor was fixed? Where were you when the gold markets were fixed? Where were you when front-running and high-frequency trading was creating these monsters of crony capitalism? Trust us? Hell no. Removing the clearinghouse and replacing it with, what's the word? It's not consortium. Cartel, that's the word. With a cartel of the same market makers who have manipulated and compromised every market in history, and doing that in a way that closes this from transparency, that's not a recipe for efficiency, immutability, security, transparency. That's not a blockchain. That's a bullshit. It's a very profitable bullshit. It requires you to have confidence in the game, a con game, as it's known. Be careful what you evaluate when you see these technologies taking something whose fundamental purpose is to remove trusted intermediaries and create an open, borderless, neutral system, and turning it into a tool for a bunch of untrustworthy trusted parties to manipulate markets is going to be a disaster, and they're going to do it. I have some consolation in the fact that their keys will leak. Because when you centralize a system, you have to keep the security of those five keys. And none of them have ever managed to do that. All of the companies involved in this brave new business as usual space have been hacked, breached, leaked, whistleblown a dozen times. They can't keep information secure. No one can. The whole point of a decentralized blockchain is you don't keep the information secure, you spread it out so thin there's no place to attack it directly. That's what makes it secure. So what happens when you concentrate it among five participants? I can't wait until the anonymous WikiLeaks collaborative dump of the titans of Wall Street and their ledger of every transaction they've ever done. I can't wait. It's going to be so much fun, and it is going to happen. You cannot secure these things. So, does that mean there's nothing there? No. Again, we go back to the other side. There is an incredibly promising technology. And that technology is based on an architecture of openness. People are examining this market, and they're grasping and reaching out in darkness. When you have a brand new disruptive technology, you can't see the margins. It's like stumbling around a dark room. Somewhere in there is a billion-dollar company. Somewhere in there is an opportunity. And you have to figure out what market exists that will create opportunity, that will change the world, that will have an impact on humanity. Entrepreneurs look at other people's problems and see them as opportunities. When journalists in 1997 were writing about the imminent failure of the internet because of the impossibility of finding anything, Larry Page and Sergey Brin were finding stuff and building a multi-billion dollar empire on solving the unsolvable problem of search. There are seemingly unsolvable problems in the open, decentralized, public, transparent, neutral, censorship-resistant, global, trustless network platform that is the blockchain and these other blockchains, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and the many other systems that are gradually trying to find their niche. Where are those markets? There are three elements to success in this industry. The first one is identifying a viable market, right? You've got to stumble in the dark and find something useful. And very often, the people stumbling in the dark, they don't find anything useful, right? In 1997, Petco was building an online commerce empire for pet supplies. It was too early. The market didn't exist. Webgrocer, Webvan, was delivering groceries to homes in San Francisco. Failed miserably. Was that the right market? Maybe. But it was the wrong time. So that's the second important element, right? Timing. You can identify something that at some point will be enormous, but you're off by a decade. And then the most important factor, sequencing, the prerequisites. Why did Facebook not happen in 1992? You didn't have enough density of adoption. You didn't have mobile devices that were permanently connected. You didn't even have home-based internet that was permanently on. You didn't have a dense social network in order to engage with the people you knew, because the people you knew barely had email or didn't have email, right? So you can't build a system of complexity that depends on many-to-many interaction with high density when you're still doing applications that are one-to-one with low density, right? It's like trying to fuse hydrogen directly into carbon. Can't do that. You've got helium, lithium, beryllium. You've got a long way to go. Keep smashing things together before you get enough density that you can start doing interesting things in organic chemistry, right? To use an example from science. Bottom line is, you can't do advanced real estate title applications, voting on the blockchain, retail markets. You can't do consumer-to-consumer dense markets. You can't do point-of-sale retail with these systems yet. You can't do most of the things yet that might be very interesting markets. And the reason you can't do them is because there's not enough liquidity, there's not enough users, there's not enough adoption, the user interfaces are terrible, the applications are still at their infant stage. That doesn't mean these things can't happen. It just means they're not happening this year. We're going to see this play out. In order for people to have the trust to put the title of their home on this blockchain, it has to be able to secure not billions, but trillions of dollars in assets. And in order to be able to secure trillions of dollars in assets, it has to have liquidity and infrastructure. It has to have broad adoption. You're not going to get adoption on a transaction that most people do twice in their lifetime when you can't even get them to use it for transactions they do every day. Right? We're not going to be doing digital identity so that everyone can have a bank account, because it takes a long time until you have adequate adoption. For the first 15 years of the internet, the application was email. And not until everybody had it, had to have it, needed it for work, did we see the second layer emerge, because that created the density of adoption. And currency is the email of blockchains. Payments are the fundamental infrastructure that will enable density of adoption. It's very, very enticing to say, this is about more than money. It is, absolutely. In the long term, the vision of this technology is far beyond money. But you can't build that unless you first build the money part. That's what creates the security. That's what creates the velocity, the liquidity, the infrastructure. That's what funds the entire ecosystem. And in the end, when we do deliver, perhaps, digital identity to people, it won't be so they can open a bank account. because this isn't about banking the unbanked. It's about debanking all of us. Thank you.
Open up for questions. There are roving mics. If I can just ask you to please wait till you get the mic, because otherwise it's not going to get picked up by the cameras.
Thank you, Andreas, for the great presentation. My name is John Karanja. I'm from Bitab Africa. So my question is on Bitcoin scaling. There's a lot of talk about scaling Bitcoin off-chain. Don't you think that going that route will open it up to the challenges you've been talking about in terms of open and borderless platforms? We would like to see as many Africans as possible using actual Bitcoin, but there is a challenge with user experience, and other blockchains like Dash claim to be solving that problem. And as a result, you can see the past few days, Dash has shot up like 400%. So how will Bitcoin evolve in a way that it will remain open, decentralized, and borderless? Thank you.
That's a great question. I think there's a fundamental misunderstanding about what it means to do second layer technologies. To use an analogy, it's almost as if a lot of people in this ecosystem are saying, we can't do TCP, we're too invested in IP, and I don't want to leave the IP space and start doing this second layer TCP stuff. TCP is IP, and second layer blockchain scaling solutions are Bitcoin. If you're doing Lightning Network or using Tumblebit or any of the other platforms that are being suggested as second layer channels for very rapid, high scale, low cost transactions between participants, what the participants are exchanging is Bitcoin transactions. Not only are they exchanging Bitcoin transactions, but these second layer technologies are fundamentally trustless. You do not need to trust the other party. You do not need to trust any of the hops in between in this routed network. Better yet, by keeping it off chain, you not only achieve scale, you achieve enormous privacy. Because these transactions are onion routed in such a way that every participant in the route only knows the previous hop and the next hop, and they don't even know if they are the source or destination. Second layer technologies offer us a way to scale dramatically, and they're not replacing on-chain transactions, they're magnifying the scale of on-chain transactions by a factor of 100 or 1,000 or even more. And so we will need to also scale on-chain transactions. Now, this is hard to do. And the reason it's hard to do on Bitcoin is because no one's in charge. And that's a feature, not a bug. If someone was in charge, they could make easy changes. But the consensus rules in Bitcoin act as a constitution that requires a super, super majority to modify, especially to modify the fundamentals, where you won't find easy consensus. That is deliberate. If you had a system that could be modified with ease, then it would be co-opted and sold out, parceled up, chopped up, and turned into boring. There's a lot of alternative currencies or competing currencies that are claiming that they have these scalability problems solved. I am extremely doubtful of these claims. Because these scalability problems are not something you solve once. They are a matter of trade-offs. The fundamental trade-offs in Bitcoin are, can you do at scale trustless? Because you can do trusted third-party intermediary at scale easily. We already have that. It's called Visa. Well, when I say we already have that, I mean about 3 billion of us have that. The other 4.5 billion, well, who cares? They didn't qualify. Why didn't they qualify? Precisely because of the third-party trust, right? Because things like KYC and AML mean economic exclusion and the poverty trap. So it's easy to say we can scale. The question is, can you scale without sacrificing the fundamental principle of trustless operation, decentralized operation, and neutrality? And that is a difficult answer. It's also the case that Bitcoin had no scaling problems in 2013. Anybody remember 2013, the golden days of zero-fee transactions and no scaling problems? Which is approximately the level of volume where Dash and Ethereum are today. It's like saying, look, my eight-year-old scored 6 goals in their junior league match. Kike only scored 2 in the previous FIFA match. My eight-year-old is rocking this soccer thing and is better than Kike. Different leagues, baby. You don't have scaling problems until you have scale, right? You don't have governance problems until you have contentious governance issues and difficult trade-offs to make. So it's easy to stand outside of the dance floor and say, I'm the best dancer. Get up and dance. And when you're trying to do it on a $15 to $19 billion scale, then we'll talk about who's scaling and who isn't. These are not easy questions to answer, and they shouldn't be minimized in this discussion, because there are very important trade-offs to be made. All right, let's take another question.
Hi, Andres.
Yes.
Thank you so much. So my question is about trust. And you know, I'm fully with you that you said Bitcoin, one of the sort of central innovations here is that it's trustless. And then it seems a little bit strange to me that you then say there's a revolution in trust because this is trustless. And it seems to me that a more accurate way of phrasing that might be like there's a revolution in self-reliance. Like you radically trust yourself to keep your own keys secure and all of this kind of stuff. And I think that, you know, like as a computer user who's, you know, relatively able to keep my computer secure and use these things, that's, you know, enormously sort of attractive to me. But I wonder if it then sort of brings in issues of social scaling. So not necessarily the technical, but like this radical self-reliance does pose quite an issue in terms of the social scale that we're talking here.
Right. That's a really great observation. I think when I say a revolution of trust, what I'm talking about is that when you organize trust in a decentralized manner, eventually you come to trust in the aggregate operation of a network, network-centric trust, and the aggregate collaboration on the same consensus rules of thousands of participants. You can't do the Bitcoin trust by yourself. You don't trust anybody. But in the end, you trust the system because everybody's using the same consensus rules. So you have this emergent model for trust in a network-centric, game-theoretical, market-based security system that is massively decentralized. In terms of self-reliance, this is a tricky one. We're at the infancy of this technology, which means that today, one of the biggest challenges is that it's very difficult for individuals to secure their own Bitcoin. And in many cases, that leads people to rely on third parties and get goxed, right? And concentrate all of their funds in one big, shiny honeypot that is an irresistible target. And, you know, as I like to say, there are two types of centralized exchanges in this world, those that have been hacked and those that will be hacked. So that's a problem. Now, you can look at that and say, that's a problem that's insurmountable, and write an article about it, just like those journalists did in 1997. Or you can say, that's a problem that if I solve with simple-to-use, easy-to-backup devices like, say, hardware wallets, and take the cost of that down, or embed it in a smartphone, or build it as a trusted chip, or make it into a necklace, and make it so cheap that you can buy this device for $1. Now, that's a billion-dollar market, right? Making Bitcoin easy to secure in an individual, empowering way that doesn't require you to centralize your assets, that's a billion-dollar project. And I think what we're seeing is the rapid development of exactly that. So, is it easy? Absolutely not. Most people who have Bitcoin, okay, let's do a quick poll. How many of you who have Bitcoin are absolutely comfortable that your Bitcoin is secure? I'm not raising my hand. That's just asking for trouble, right? That's tempting karma. I am reasonably certain that I have managed to maintain my security for the last 5 years. And, you know, I have a master's degree, which was mostly focused on information security. That's not the level that most people will have. So how do you make it easy for everyone? How do you make it seamless? How do you make it transparent? How do you make it invisible? There are great companies that do just that. I like to tell people I sent my first email in 1989. My mother sent her first email in 2009, 20 years to the day after that. Sending my first email involved downloading mail software from the BSD distribution, compiling it with a compiler on a Unix command line, firing it off, setting up a mailbox, attaching to a remote store and forward UUCP copy server, sending the email, waiting 3 days for it to traverse the internet. Elapsed time, 6 hours of highly complicated computer science. My mom went swish on her iPad. Right? That's the skills gap. So how do we make it so that securing your Bitcoin is swish? And the company that solves that, and it is solvable, and makes it intuitive, reflexive, that company is going to be very successful. And I think there are a lot of companies competing for exactly that. So you're right. We're not there yet. That's why I say we're in the internet of 1992. There's no DNS. There's no web. You use Archer and Gopher to get information. Sending an email is an exercise in frustration, and you have to compile all of your software. Right? Still 2 years away from Netscape. That's where we are. And that means that for now, this is not going to be a broad-based phenomenon. It is going to be something that it requires a lot of technical skill. We are not the early adopters. Those of us who are involved in Bitcoin, we are the lunatic fringe. The early adopters are 5 years out. Right? That's what it means to be involved in this space. And it's OK. If your friends are making fun of you, you're probably doing something interesting. All right, maybe one more question?
Yeah, we can take another.
Thanks, Andreas.
Thank you.
I really enjoyed the testimony you gave to the Australian Senate, and I thought that was excellent. In it, you mentioned and warned against the dangers of custodial accounts.
Yes.
And at that point, I realized that all of my cryptocurrency was actually locked up in custodial accounts, and by implication, it wasn't mine because I didn't have the private keys.
Yes.
How do you, in practice, use Bitcoin both as a long-term store of value and as something that you transact with between all the options available, paper wallets, potentially custodial accounts, other kinds of online wallets, etc.
How do I personally use that?
Yeah, and how would you recommend one actually goes about in practice using it?
Okay. Since 2013, the maximum amount of time I have left currency, crypto or fiat, on an exchange is 15 minutes. I transact weekly, sometimes more often. I don't day trade. That's not my purpose. I use it as a working currency. I get paid in Bitcoin. I get paid in Ethereum. I use these currencies to pay my bills, to live. I live in the Bitcoin community. And so I have to transact. And I often have to exchange, because I can't always buy the things I want with cryptocurrencies. How do I exchange? In and out. In, three confirmations, sell, ACH, or bank transfer, out. I don't even leave fiat on exchanges. I don't trust them to hold money. I don't trust banks to hold money. How am I going to trust a two-year-old startup that has six employees? Are you kidding me? So I don't leave money on exchanges. Now, that's difficult to do if you're day trading. And if you're day trading in this environment with these, you know, these assets of great volatility, I mean, you're a brave person. Now, how do I use it? Most of my holdings are in tiers. So think of it as warm or hot to cold all the way down to deep freeze, right? On the cold side, I hold a small amount, honestly, because this hasn't been a most profitable idea, jumping into an untested technology and not getting paid for a couple of years. But anyway, I have a whole small amount of Bitcoin that I hold in deep cold storage. That means that they're held on keys that are not instantiated on any device, that exist in such a way that they're encrypted with a memorized passphrase, which I have also communicated to people who might become my heirs so that they don't get lost with me. And that's cold storage. Then I have an intermediate tier, which is on a hardware wallet, actually several hardware wallets. Again, PIN protected, passphrase protected, backed up with mnemonic phrases. And then I go to the warm tier, right? I have a small amount of operating cash that I use for my businesses to pay subcontractors, et cetera, et cetera. Those are in multi-signature, either multi-signature, multi-party wallets, meaning there are other people who are required to consent, or multi-signature, multi-factor wallets, in which case I'm the only party, but I have several devices that need to sign independently in order to exercise a transaction. And finally, I have my hot wallet, which is in my back pocket, and is, at the moment, mycelium. I keep a couple $100, mostly for the purpose of giving everybody a Bitcoin as if I'm the Oprah of cryptocurrencies. You have a Bitcoin, and you have a Bitcoin. Well, actually, a millibit, because things are going well. A millibit for you and a millibit for you. So, to answer your question, I have tiers. And I never keep on my hot wallet more than I'm comfortable keeping in cash in my physical wallet as fiat. And I often have to move things around in order to manage it. So far, I have only lost Bitcoin through my own stupidity. Like, for example, misplacing a backup and then trashing my phone. I've lost small amounts, like less than $100. I've never been hacked. Fingers crossed, I don't assume I won't be hacked. I assume I might. But as long as it's on the warm side of my wallets, I can take that risk. All right. So, wrapping that up, I'd like to also say, if any of you are interested in experiencing a Bitcoin transaction, trying it out, using Bitcoin in a small way, I would be happy to help you set up a wallet on your smartphone. I'd be happy to do that with Ether, if you want, also, and give you a small amount so you can transact with your friends. Anybody else who wants to volunteer, raise your hand, who's going to help people get Bitcoin. Okay, look at these people. Find them during the break. And try it. It's actually really important that you experience this and see how it works for yourself. Thank you so much for coming today.
Andreas, thank you very much. Thank you.